Yeah, hello and welcome to Cimbrer Bushcraft, Viking Heritage. You can see I'm out in my Cimbrer camp today to making this Yule special, or Yule special, or Christmas special, or whatever. I'll talk about that a little bit later. And it's going to be a very talking video, because I have a lot of things to tell you and about the Christmas in Denmark and some tradition we have. And beside that, I have a special thing I would like to prepare over my fire, so I can eat that along with my coffee. And I'm talking about that a little bit later too. You saw I put up some more chimneys. Some of you very friendly subscribers told me that the chimney should be higher. It should be at least 2 meters, then will it be more efficient. So I have the tubes and I put them on now. So I'll see if it works better now. Yeah. Well, it's a wonderful day out here in Cimbrer camp. The sun is shining, but unfortunately most of the snow is gone. We have had very warm weather the last week, so only a few places there's snow still. But nevertheless, it's a wonderful day, and I'm looking very much forward to celebrate Yule here in Denmark. Yeah. So now I think I'm going to prepare my fire and see if this chimney and my smoke hood are more efficient. So hang on. Nice cup of strong coffee and a little bit of salt in. Yips. And while I'm waiting for my coffee to be done, I would like to tell you a little bit about the name Yule Christmas. Yeah. Now I said Merry Christmas. Here in Denmark we don't call it Christmas, we call it Yule. That's the name nowadays. In the old days they called it Jol or Jule. And it's way back from the Viking age that it was named that way. Many are saying it's the winter solstice that is celebrated during the Viking age, and yeah, it's almost true because the celebration, the winter solhverv, was held in January. It depends on the full moon and so on, but it was in January, mostly in the last part of January. There was a blood, a sacrifice of different things to the gods. But then the Christian came and they put the Yule together with Christmas, and then it was celebrated here in the end of December. So that's why, yeah. And we still call it Yule in Sweden and Norway, I know.
Yeah, and now the coffee has boiled. I'll put it down here, and then I'll put the things on that I have told you about. It is this. We call them Æbleskiver, and I'll tell you why. Or actually, the story behind these Æbleskiver, and a little funny story too.
And these Æbleskiver, translated to apple slice, is an old Danish tradition. And the ingredients is the same as you make pancakes from, but you fry them in a special pan so they get round here. You can see, yeah, have to be careful not to burn them. Yeah. Nowadays, there's no apples in these Æbleskiver, but in the old days, and the original was a slice of apple that you dipped in eggs and flour and fried on the pan, and that's why it's called Æbleskiver. I don't know how in this process the slices were round like these, and but that's the reason why it's called Æbleskiver. And you eat them with jam and powdered sugar, and it tastes delicious. It's a dessert or something you can eat while you're drinking coffee or glühwein. It's a tradition that we do that here in Denmark in December. Yeah, not many are making them the old-fashioned way in that pan, so most people buy them as I do, frozen, and then warm them in the oven, and it's very delicious. In a moment I think they are done, and then I can taste these. It's the first time this year I'm tasting Æbleskiver. I think they are done. Then I have to put some jam in here. Very delicious. And strawberry jam. I like that. Then you just dip them in. Looks like this inside. When you make them on that pan, they are often hollow inside, so they can hold a lot of jam. it's the worst possible weather to film in because the sun is very low, but not as low as it can light up all the interior of my shelter. So down it's dark and up it's dark, so just this little frame I can use for filming. Yeah. Mm. Yeah. And then I had a little funny story I would like to tell you. And it was something I saw in the Danish TV. It seems that in Iowa there's a little town called Elkhorn, and it's founded, or it was a Dane that was their first and make a town, and there's a lot of Danish people living in Elkhorn, very kind people, and they want to continue with the Danish traditions, so they make Æbleskiver or apple slice in December like we do, but somehow in the time from where the Danes that could remember it in Denmark until now, there was a little mix-up because they thought, or they say, they eat æbleskiver, apple slice, together with medisterpølse. And medisterpølse is a sausage, a long sausage that you fry in the pan and then cut out in small pieces and eat to potatoes and gravy and so on. So medisterpølse is a dish you have for the main course, and æbleskiver is not really a dessert, but something you eat in the afternoon together with your coffee. But it's a funny little story because the tradition fades out a little bit during the times from medisterpølse to æbleskiver. That's a long way, but I think it was a little funny story, and I love those stories about how things are changing during generations. They are trying to keep up the Danish spirit there, and I greet you all in Elkhorn if anyone is watching my videos. Yeah. And skål to all. And it's the first time I make æbleskiver over open fire, and it's really delicious. Very crispy in there. In the outside. It tastes very good. Yeah, and as a little extra bonus, I made a DIY video. I know a lot of you are very fond of those. So I made a little sheath for this peasant knife from Schwert that I got from a friendly subscriber friend. And you can see I made it so that it will sit an angle on my belts. But yeah. I made a little video about how I made this sheath. I would like to show you that now. Yeah, and I'm going to make a couple of templates for this sheath to this little awesome sheath knife. First I do this, I mark where the folding knife is. And then I draw around it where the backside of the sheath will be. And this is approximately because I can always adjust it later. Then I cut it out. So I have a template of paper, and then I have to check it first, looking good, and then I transfer it to a piece of leather. And remember, this is the backside, the first backside. I'm going to make two, you'll understand that later. And this is some old leather that I have used for other things, but now I'm using it for this, and it's okay. use a sharp knife to cut it out. Be careful not to cut yourself. Yeah. Then we have the first piece of leather. And then I'm going to make the leather that is on top, the first part of the sheath. And it is just very loose. Again, approximately, give it a little more than less. You can't add some leather. We can easily remove some. So now I have the upper part, or the outside of the leather. Yeah. And then I sand it. And I always sand my leather because then it doesn't get glossy when I apply leather color. And I like the old school look of it. It's going to be matte. Then I put it in water, let it soak there for some minutes. Yeah, and then I take some plastic wrappings, fold out from the kitchen I normally use for food, and I wrap the little knife in that, because of course it's going to be wet, and if I don't do this, the knife will rust. So I wrap it tight, and to secure it, I use some tape here, you can see. So it's going to be a tight wrapping around the knife. And this is exactly the same thing you do if it is a ordinary knife. You wrap the whole knife in plastic. Yeah, then it's finished. You can see no water will penetrate this. And then I've made such two little pieces of wood that I can use in a moment. It has to have the size or the shape of the little knife. And then I take the leather when it has soaked in water and put it around, and this is where these two are used to keep the leather in place, and I secure it with these clamps from both sides. Very tight, so the sheet will be tied to the knife. And then a little piece of wood there to finish it up. Yeah. And before I'm going to dry it, I will try to wet mold it a little bit, apply some water, and then with my finger, trying to make the shape of the folding knife in the sheath. This is not something you have to do, but I think it's looking good. Then it's going to be dry. I'll take that some hours. And when it's dry, I take it off. Yeah. And again, checking it still fits. Yeah, a tight fit. It has to be that. Yeah, and now I have to apply the back side of the sheath. So I have the front side and the back side. And then I'll mark it where the glue shall be. And apply some glue
And this glue is something you can buy for leatherworks. You put it on and then you let it dry for a couple of minutes. And when it's dry, you can put them together and it will be a very strong connection. We call this glue for contact glue. Yeah, then I put it together and checking again, is it okay? It's not 100% correct, but I'll make it that afterwards. Yeah, checking again, does it fit? Yeah, it looks nice. And I have these little clamps that I can use to secure it when it's drying. Yeah, and it'll dry in half an hour or so. Yeah, and now it's finished. I have to work on it now. Yeah, this little one I use for many things. Now I'm using it to mark where the cutting will be, where I want to cut the sheath. And I use this because the distance from the upper part to the lower part will be the same. And mark it again so I can see it. Yeah, and cut it again with a sharp knife. It's a little bit more difficult because it's two layers now, but the sharp knife will do the job. Yeah. And then I have to sand it again on the edges to make it fine and even. You can use hand sandpaper or a machine, it doesn't matter. Just have to be smooth. Yeah. And then I make another marking, and this time it's for the stitching. I use the same tool. This time I use it from the outside and to the inside and mark where the stitching are going to be. Yeah, and then I punch the holes with this little thing. And you use such a tool because the holes will be equally divided. I have a video about how I make leatherworks, and I'll put a link in the last part of this video, so you can find that video where I tell about my tools, my leather tools. Yeah, and now you can see all the holes are nice and even. And then I'm going to make the other backside. And I have to turn the leather because it's going to be, it's going to be more beautiful this way. Yeah. And this is the final backside. This is the backside where I will have my my leather on, my leather belt. So yeah, here you can see how it looks. It has three times leather, and then this is a template for my belt, how wide it is, and I'm making some markings, and I want to make the sheets a little bit at an angle on my leather beds. That's why I make it this way. This is how it's going to be on my belt. Make some holes here. Four places. This way. And cut it out like this. Side too. Yeah, now this is finished. I can see the belt can go in and it will be at an angle on my hip. So everything looks good until now. And again, I sandpaper it. I have to glue it on with the same type of glue I used before, and be careful here not to glue the inside or the middle of the leather, because that's where the belt will go in. So only on the outside apply glue, and again of course on both items. Yeah, and then it's dry and I put them together. And usually these small clamps again to hold it in place while it's drying. Yeah. And then check if the leather is okay. There's no glue inside there. So that's where the belt will be. And then again, sander it, sandpaper it to make it smooth. And fine. And you see that, yeah, I use this little tool to make the edges round and even finer. And you saw that the holes are not going completely through all the leather, so after I've done this, yeah, you can see looking fine. Yeah, then I have a little drill and I drill the holes all down the leather. One at a time. Easy. And if you don't have such a little drill machine, you can use other things. Yeah, and here you see the holes are going through all three layers of leather. And then I apply some color, some leather dye, and I use something that I call golden brown. You apply it on the outside and the back. Yeah, and I apply the color before the stitching because I want this white thread to be visible. Then I start the stitching. Again, my video where I show all my leather working tools, you can see more techniques about how I do this. I use a double stitching, which means I have two needles with the same thread, where the one is going out. Yeah. going out there. And then the other one is going in. Yeah. This is the start. One in. Yeah, and you just continue this way, all the way around this little sheath. Of course, you have to have a little bit patient when you're doing this. I love doing this. I think it's very relaxing. And if you haven't tried leatherwork before, you really should. It's so relaxing and enjoyable to make your own thing. See, I use a little pry because they are so tight, I can't take it through with my hands at the second needle. Not every time. Yeah. I just have to finish it and check, yeah, it fits. Then I apply some leather fat. People are asking me what kind. Well, any kind you can get for shoes or other stuff, leather. Beeswax can also be used, but let it soak in, because the leather will it's very dry after you have had it in water. And then I use this little tool to make the edges more smooth again. That's not something you have to do, but I think it makes it look a little bit more finished. And then I use sandpaper again, and that's because I want to make it look old school and worn out and not new. I want it to look like something I have had for years. So I sandpaper it. Yeah. And then it's finished. I put it in, and here you can see on my belt how it is. Tight fit, it has to be that. So, this is the little sheath for my sword peasant knife. Yeah, I think it's nice. And I hope you like it too. Thank you for watching this little video. Yeah, hope you think it was an interesting video. It's not a big thing making a sheet like this, but now you got an idea of how I make them. So I think I'll have this on my Viking belt kit, but I can also use it with my bushcraft. So I have the two options for that. And those of you who haven't seen this knife, it's really awesome. A peasant knife. Very simple knife that was used many, many years ago and still have a lot of value. Now I would like to tell you a little bit about the Christmas goat, julegid. Julebuk, as we call it here in Denmark and in Scandinavian. Yeah, and the Jule goat, or Christmas goat, it is a Viking tradition at winter solstice, where they sacrifice the goat to the old Nordic god Thor, so that it would be a good new year with good crops and healthy animal stock. The Jule goat was made of straw with red ribbons wrapped around it, sometimes equipped with a hammer to resemble the thunder god Thor. Later in the 17th century, the Yule goat was a strange creature in the shape of a goat, and often a person dressed out like a goat and would entertain the Christmas parties gathering, and often very provoking. The Yule goat is one of the oldest Nordic Christmas symbols. Yeah. So this little goat, our Julebuk,
is an old symbol from the pagan times, the heathen. It's a heathen symbol that we still use here in Scandinavia. And yeah, this is one that I've had for many years, and it is on my attic. And every time it's December, I'll take it down and put it in my living room. So this is a story about the Christmas goat, or the Julebuk. Thor had two goats that was dragging his wagon up in the sky when he was up there. So a symbol for Thor. This is all for now, folks. I hope you enjoyed this little video. It's been a wonderful day out here in Cimbrer camp. The sun is shining, but it's not good when I'm recording my videos. So I hope the footage is okay. You can see what it is. Yeah. I hope you find my little stories about Æbleskiver, Jule goat, and the name Jule interesting, and perhaps learn a thing or two. It's probably going to be my last video this year, because now my son and daughter is coming to visit us in the Christmas and New Year, so I'm not sure I have time for going out and make any more videos this year. So Merry Christmas, Happy Holidays, Glædelig Jul, wherever you are and wherever you call it. Yeah, I'm very grateful for all the support I've got this year. The last month has been fantastic. I gained a lot of new subscribers. Welcome to you all. I think I'm passing the 80,000 now, so I'm very grateful for that. Yeah, and I'm going to pack my gear and heading home, and then have a little holiday together with my family. Yeah, thank you again for watching Cimbrer Bushcraft. I really appreciate that, and hope to see you again on the next one. Bye bye, take care.